lesson for our time from the idea of the wheel-turning monarch found in the suttas. Of course, this is one of the most famous stories, the birth story of the Buddha, the wise man and the Buddha. So let's talk a little bit about that wheel-turning monarch.
Well, when at a rare, very rare intervals of time, a human being is born with the 32 marks of a great man, Mahapurusa, and one who has those marks will inevitably become either a Buddha or a Chakravarti, a wheel-turning monarch. So the wheel-turning monarch is, in that sense, a secular counterpart of the Buddha. These are like the two supreme pinnacles of human development. So when the Buddha Gautama was born, wise men saw these marks on him and made this prognostication. He will either be a Buddha or a wheel-turning monarch. And his father, being a worldly and ambitious ruler, wanted his son to grow up to be the conqueror of the world, and surrounded him with sense pleasures to try and divert his mind towards the worldly ambition. Mm-hmm. But in this case, it didn't work. But the wheel-turning monarch has a whole mythology surrounding him. Mm-hmm. And they do arise at very rare intervals in the world. What happens is that a wheel appears in the sky, an eight-spoked wheel. And the people in the town see it coming from a long way off, and they wonder, what is this? Is this a second moon? What is this coming? And eventually it settles over the palace of the king, and the king recognizes it as the Dhamma wheel, the Dhamma Chaka. And he pays obeisance, he sprinkles it with water, and then he's now recognized as the Dhammachaka, Chakravarti, the wheel-turning monarch. And he follows the wheel. The wheel progresses through the sky, and the king with his army and his whole entourage and all the people, the artisans and so on, they all rise up into the sky and float through the air behind the wheel.
Ah, wow.
And he goes from kingdom to kingdom.
Yes.
And the other kings come out with their armies, and seeing the wheel, they make obeisance and pay homage to the Chakravarti. Mm. And he admonishes them to keep the precepts and rule justly, and they become his vassals. So he conquers the whole earth without stick or sword. Mm. Peaceful conquest of the entire world. And he goes from not only this island, Jambudvipa, but goes to the other three islands, conquers all the entire world system.
And these other islands are actually not necessarily earthly islands?
They aren't, in a way. They're, in a sense, they're almost like other planets. They're so far away, they can't be reached by earthly means, ordinary means.
Right.
These the four world islands on either side of the central mountain.
Yeah. So this wheel that appears in it is starting to sound very suspicious.
Yes, yes.
As this visitors from another planet or another dimension.
I don't leave that for people to decide for them for themselves.
We won't.
But there is a very long description of the wheel in one of the commentaries.
Yeah.
Goes into very minute detail, and it sounds very mechanical, all these kind of metal tubes and parts and pieces all.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
There's no inhabitants of the wheel.
There's never mentioned anything about any beings associated with the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
The wheel seems to be an entity unto itself.
Yeah, certainly the wheels are extremely important inventions, the invention of the wheel. Of course, the wheel is also the wheel, some speculation about the wheel of the sun moving across the sky. But, you know, they knew what the sun was.
And
they, they would have said, it's the sun. So there, it's something very strange, very interesting, and it's very rare. And it seems to appear to everybody. And it's a kind of, we might call it perhaps the charisma, a representation of charisma of the of this world turning emperor. And so he conquers, I think the last something world ruling emperor that I can imagine is maybe the Queen Victoria. Remember the sun never set on the British Empire, so and she sat on the throne for 60 years. But it wasn't a peaceful, they conquered with the stick and the sword. And so this is a purely peaceful, a very appealing kind of charisma that people are willing to, a federation, more or less, of other countries become, are willing to form federations.
And it's a very idealized. Like, I think we find in the Buddhist scriptures a, an ambivalent attitude towards kingship. That there's one sutta where the Buddha is contemplating whether it is possible for a king to rule justly without stick or sword. And Mara appears to him and tries to tempt him and says, you have the power. Why don't you turn the Himalayan mountains into gold and use the wealth to benefit sentient beings and make yourself king of the world? And the Buddha says, I know you, Mara, and dismisses him. But the question is never answered. Is it possible to rule without stick or sword? And then practical monarchs at the Buddhist time, of course, were not able to do that. You know, they had punishments of the wrongdoers, and they went to war with each other. So, in on a ordinary worldly plane, it doesn't seem to be happen. So you have this idealized picture of the wheel turning monarch, who is able to rule justly over the whole earth without any use of force.
Yeah, it's an aspiration. I guess as we move along in history, we come a little closer to it. You know, the idea that you could have a country without capital punishment is a very recent idea.
Yeah, this is true,
In Canada, 1968, I think it was, some of the Scandinavian countries, they also don't have standing armies, so it's perhaps that aspiration to peaceful rule. But you see how far the Buddhist scriptures are ahead of time. They're envisioning the possibility of nonviolence.
So, and how the wheel-turning monarch finances his regime is also idealized. Because taxation is, of course, not a desirable thing. And what happens is he's progressing through the air following the wheel. The wheel suddenly plunges into the ocean, and the two sides of the ocean pull apart and form like walls, so that the king and his entire entourage descend to the through the air to the floor of the sea. And at that spot where they descend is covered with jewels, and they gather all these jewels up, and this is what finances the king's good works.
Right, and notice that there's no open pit mining involved. Which is it must have been in a very oppressive work project in the good old days. People with shovels and picks. So that, in fact, of course, there are countries that just happen to be rich in these kind of natural resources, and they really don't have to labor too much. In our own time, we have Saudi Arabia, Norway, and things like that, with the oil gushing out of the ground, Texas. So that's a that's an interesting vision, and it happens sometimes in history, doesn't it? So it's idealized, And also the awareness of taxation. They're not disconnected from what we consider modern. They know how government happens.
Oh, yeah.
And you have, everybody has to contribute.
Yeah.
Taxation has to happen. And it has to be, it can be unjust or it can be just.
Mm.
Yeah. So this choice, remember the story of the, what is the eight wise men who come to the birth of the Buddha, or the birth of the Bodhisattva. He's not the Buddha yet.
Yes.
They make, and seven of them predict that he could be either world-turning monarch or a Buddha. And it'd be interesting to know what they meant by the word Buddha, you know, because obviously Buddhism wasn't invented, but some sort of power, a very charismatic religious leader versus a very charismatic political leader. And one of them decides there's only one possible fate for this, that he's going to be a Buddha.
Yeah.
This is a very interesting area. I had to contemplate this as well, even in ordaining my early days, that which is it that does more good? A just society can help, you know, a monarch or a great leader can change the lives of a lot of people by redistributing wealth and making justice happen and so forth. Mm. Is it really a better idea to renounce the world and go off than to be active politically? So it's a vital question even now, isn't it?
Like, yes.
What, and of course, many people don't understand, well, what are those monks doing anyways? Mm. Parasites are useless, you know, on the outside. But they answer that question. They answer this. Even this idealized world-ruling monarch is not as valuable as a Buddha.
Mm.
Because the nature of the Buddha is that it persists enormously through time, even after the end of a kingdom.
Mm.
And what empires have lasted? I think the longest surviving empire was the Byzantine Empire, 700 years.
Mm.
Now the Sasana is 2,500 years old, so we have outlasted the longest, most glorious empires on the earth. So I think it's a very good question. I really appreciated this story because it poses the absolute optimal political solution to the miseries of life.
Yeah.
Could you bring justice and well-being through these means? Is that the solution, or is it a spiritual solution? Does that is that a more efficacious solution to the situation?
Well, one limitation of even the idealized political solution is it doesn't address the most fundamental causes of human suffering: birth, old age, sickness, and death.
Right.
Those are beyond political.
Yes.
Political solution. The political solution can at best ameliorate conditions within samsara. It doesn't transcend samsara.
I notice we're in a time where we are trying to, through technology and medicine and so forth, eliminate suffering.
Mm.
And some of the solutions we're coming up with is euthanasia.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I know we will gently kill you.
Yeah.
Because the problem of aging and illness is unsolvable ultimately, except through death, if that's a solution.
Yeah.
So we don't like to suffer, but we don't have any spiritual solutions, so we'll just give you an easy way out.
Mm.
So these are the attempts to solve this problem through political means always fall short and end up, sometimes they lead to catastrophes as well. Mm. I can very well see that the overuse of euthanasia happening.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the this monarch, when he goes to the different countries, what do the rulers of the country, how do they negotiate with him?
They're overawed by the presence of the wheel in the sky. And they simply submit to him.
Right.
But him being, he doesn't exploit the situation, mm-hmm. being a naturally righteous person. That's why he was chosen to be the wheel turner. He simply admonishes the king to keep the five precepts mm-hmm. and allows him to continue to rule as his vassal. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't dispossess anyone.
Right. And shortly after the Buddha, we have this Emperor Asoka mm-hmm. in India, yeah. who seemed to attempt to model or emulate that yes. idea.
Yeah, he definitely used that as like propaganda for his regime, the image of the wheel-turning monarch. And he did try and rule justly, mm-hmm. but he conquered before he turned to the Buddhist Dhamma. He did conquer with the sword
yes.
most of India. Thereafter, he ruled righteously as possible in ordinary worldly condition. And they developed a ideology that was an extension of the Chakravarti idea, was the classical Chakravarti found in the Pali texts, was a conqueror of the entire world, including the four islands. Asoka claimed to be a Chakravarti of one island, so, which is Jambudipa,
yeah.
or which is in mythological terms, it's the ordinary world, but in practical geographical terms, it was the subcontinent of India.
Right.
So he did have the whole basically known world under his rule.
Mm-hmm.
And so he
very large empire.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Yeah. So that was the most successful or well-established attempt at establishing a kind of Chakravarti on earth in historical times. But many Buddhist rulers have used that imagery.
Mm-hmm.
It's a common motif. Yeah.
Talk about that story of the world-ruling emperor who it wasn't enough to just rule this world.
Yes, this is a story of Mandata. He was one of the Chakravartis who began with the archetypal career of a Chakravarti conquering the whole earth, all four islands. But then he felt that this was not enough. He felt unsatisfied, and he asked his advisors, what else is there to conquer?
Mm-hmm.
And they told him, well, there's this realm of the four great kings. So he led his army up the side of Mount Sinuru. And the four great kings came forth, the gods, and submitted to him. And he ruled over their realm. And he ruled there for a very long time. And then he became dissatisfied once more. And his advisors told him there is still a greater place at the top of Mount Sinuru, the Tao Tingsa heaven.
Mm-hmm.
So he climbed up the rest of the way up the mountain. And Sakya came forth and like all the other kings, he was overawed by the wheel, but Sakya was more powerful than any other ruler. So he didn't submit completely. He said, I'll share the kingdom with you. Mm-hmm. And they ruled side by side. They set up side by side thrones and ruled together. And Mandata, it said that he lived so long that he outlived 16 Sakyas.
Mm-hmm.
And Sakyas, as a Tao Tingsa level of heaven, they live for 57 million years. So, so he was quite a...
16 times 57. You can do the math yourself.
Do the math, yeah. it comes out to be a very long time. And at that point, he grew dissatisfied again. And he thought to himself, why am I sharing rule with this fellow? Why don't I kill him and take over? And as soon as he had that unworthy thought, he lost the protection of the wheel. And the wheel sank to earth, and he fell along with it. He fell to earth, and before he died, you know, people asked him what had happened, and he said, this is what happens when you have unsatisfied desire.
Right.
And it's taken as a model of, or an archetype of the unsatisfiability of sensual desire.
Yeah.
That no matter how much you get, you always want more.
Right. And the sensual desire, but also political power. Power,
yes.
And desire.
Yeah.
Now we have, I mean, it sounds outlandish, but actually you see Kennedy announcing in the early 60s that America would go to the moon.
Yeah.
So nothing is, there is a never satisfied.
Yeah.
We're always, and we went to the moon, we landed, came back, and we went again, and then we stopped doing that.
Yeah.
So it was just now we're talking about Mars and so forth,
yeah.
But it's very clear that the humans, some aspect of unwise human wants to conquer the universe. The world is not enough. All of the universe must be had.
Yeah.
So it's an aspiration to an insatiable aspiration. Of course, all it takes is the slightest taint for it to all fall apart as well.
Yeah.
And you see this, see Tsar Nicholas in Russia.
Yeah.
In history, you know, I actually perhaps the wealthiest person in history. And it wasn't very long till the Marxists overthrew that situation.
Yeah.
And then they got their opportunity to taint the whole thing as well. They only lasted 70 years.
Mm.
Capitalism and Marxism compete for this idea of to rule the world. They're going to bring this great idea to you.
Mm-hmm.
And they're kind of shocked when you don't embrace it. And so at that point, it becomes necessary that the ends justify the means.
Mm.
And it turns to violence as well. We see these stories just playing out again and again and again.
Yeah.
So this deep insight into human nature.
When in the ordinary human existence attempts to ameliorate human conditions through political means end up like the French Revolution or the Russian Revolution, end up with a lot of bloodshed.
Yes.
And they start with what could be considered a noble idea. They want to help people, but they find it impossible to rule without stick or sword.
Because the impurity of the heart, so it's not possible to establish an ultimately just empire without purification of the heart. And then at the purification of the heart, one realizes the limits of any possible material arrangement and ultimately falls apart. Any other areas of curiosity and interest for the world-turning monarch?
There's a story of a succession of world-turning monarchs that ruled over many generations, and in each case the elder would, when he reached old age, which was measured in tens of thousands of years, he would go off and practice as an ascetic in the forest, and his son took over. And this lasted for several generations until one of the kings failed to keep the duties of the wheel-turning monarch. Which include providing for the poor, and he didn't do that.
Yes,
and that led to crime and violence in the kingdom, and he lost the protection of the wheel, and the whole thing fell apart.
Yeah, very good. And perhaps in a future talk, we will discuss the 10 duties of a king. Is very pertinent to our time as well.
Yeah.
There's so much discussion about what government should do, whether you need a minimal government or a substantially interfering type of government.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of wisdom to be found in the Buddhist analysis of this, what the actual duty of the government is to people and what its function is.
And there's in the Aganya Sutta, the origin of kingship is kind of interesting, because that has the Buddha come down on a definite side in something that's been a political issue in Europe between in early modern and pre-modern times, there was the theory of divine right of kingship.
Yes.
The kings ordained by God. Mm-hmm. And then this was supplanted by the social contract theory of Locke and Hobbes, that the government was essentially an agreement amongst people. We have to, you know, end the state of chaos. Mm-hmm. And that's the side the Buddha takes. And he was quite explicit that he was criticizing the Brahmanical view of the divine ordaining of society. And he takes a very practical view that human beings were degenerating morally. And previously they'd lived in a harmonious state of nature, but now they were starting to steal and lie and rob from each other. And so they got together and decided, we need somehow to sort this out. So we'll choose one amongst us to be the ruler, and he can punish the wrongdoers.
Right.
And they elected this fellow they call Mahasamata, the great elect.
Yes.
And he was the first of the kings of humans.
Right.
So in that sense, government becomes like a necessary evil.
Yeah.
Because humans are imperfect. They have to have some governance over them.
Right. And I think in the story, there's also an inevitable story of decline, because when you have to enforce things by power, people try to get around that power,
yes.
and then they arm themselves, and then it becomes a kind of a continuous civil
yes.
war as well.
Yes.
So he, obviously, they just didn't have a lot of hope for some sort of mechanical sorting this out. It's either a voluntary commitment to sila, where everything gets better, sila being virtue.
Yeah.
Everything just gets better when people voluntarily cooperate, practice generosity, kindness, and clarity. Things get better.
Mm-hmm.
And when you need to do this by authority to keep people in line, it just is a matter of time before it declines.
Yes.
Yeah. The rule of law is not enough to make life, to help people understand why they should be good.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the little discussion on the world-ruling monarch, and lots of lessons to be learned from that.